Hi, my name is Eli Dart from ESnet. I'm going to talk a little bit about the science DMZ. Data-intensive science requires the movement of data between geographically distant institutions. And so data-intensive science then requires the data transfer performance that matches the data scale of the science collaboration. If you have to move the data from place to place, you need a set of tools and technologies that can accommodate the scale of the data that you have to move. Science data growth is exponential at this stage of the game. Humans, unfortunately, are not exponential entities, and so we need tools and architectures that can continue to scale as the data growth scales without requiring the humans to scale up the level of effort that they put into accomplishing the data movement. So in order to move data at scale, we really need to be able to do that over the network. Some people ship disks. Shipping disks is labor-intensive, human labor-intensive. It's slow and it's error-prone. And most importantly, there are entire classes of scientific workflows that are unavailable to you if you're stuck moving data by shipping physical media. So what we'd like then is to have a set of tools and technologies that will scale up and that we can automate to and make data-intensive science function cleanly and efficiently. Science networks are up to the task at this point. Most network backbones in the United States are 100 gigabit backbones at this point. There are 10 gigabit backbones in most of the rest of the world, or 100 gigabit backbones as well. So network infrastructure-wise, the backbones are, to a first order, big, fast, and clean at this point. If you look at the scale of data that people often need to move, it's 1 terabyte up to the hundreds of terabytes. But if you look at what that actually means in the context of network backbone speeds, a terabyte a day only requires 100 megabits per second of throughput. 100 terabytes in a week requires a gigabit and a half. If you can go to a terabyte an hour, that only requires 2.5 gigabits per second. It's fairly straightforward to see how the, if you have a 10 gigabit or 100 gigabit network backbone, that the amount of data that you have to move fits easily within those network backbones. The trick then is to make sure that the infrastructure at the edges, right, what's connected to the backbone, is also as capable and can effectively use the network backbone for moving the data between the geographically distant institutions that we have to do for data-intensive science. The science DMZ provides a set of design patterns for building and operating the infrastructure at the end sites. So what is a science DMZ? A science DMZ is a network enclave located at or near the site perimeter. It contains dedicated infrastructure for data transfer. It's built from high-performance components. Performance measuring and monitoring is built in and integrated from day one. And the security model used deploys performant security mechanisms, right? Security policies and security policy enforcement mechanisms that do not trade security for performance or performance for security. And so when you put all these things together, you have a set of composable design patterns that can be used to build high-performance data transfer infrastructure. So I have here a picture. It's a bit of an abstract cartoon. Nobody's network looks exactly like this, but this is the minimum network diagram that sort of contains all of the different pieces of a science DMZ. So we have a wide area network that's the connection to the outside world and to other collaborating institutions. The site connects to that wide area network by means of a border router, just like in normal regular network design. Connected directly to that border router is a science DMZ switch or science DMZ router. And connected to the science DMZ switch or science DMZ router is the data transfer node, which is that dedicated host for data transfer. So if you look then at the path from the wide area and the remote collaborating institution into that data transfer node, there's a very small number of devices in the path. There's a border router, a switch router for the science DMZ, and the data transfer node itself. This is very different from dragging that traffic flow through a dozen wiring closet switches across several buildings. And so the testing and troubleshooting footprint is small in case of problems. It's easy to instrument. You'll note that there are perf sonar boxes at several locations in the diagram. These are there for a reason. They're there for fault isolation and for ongoing network measurement. And if someone from the site or campus LAN needs to fetch data out of that data transfer node, yes, that traffic flow will traverse the potentially problematic enterprise firewall, but the delay or the latency between the data transfer node and the device on the campus network is so small that the packet loss problems that firewall might cause are unlikely to affect performance in the same way that they would if that traffic flow was going all the way across the wide area in through that firewall and directly to whatever the end host is on the campus. And if you look then at the enterprise traffic flow or the commodity traffic flow, it doesn't traverse the science DMZ at all. And so the enterprise traffic, the commodity traffic, doesn't traverse the science DMZ. The wide area data transfers to the science DMZ don't traverse the commodity path, other than the shared science network backbone in the wide area and the border router. So that separation is useful from a security policy perspective and from a performance engineering perspective. But this shows the way in which the basic components of a science DMZ can be assembled to provide a good environment for a high-performance data transfer node to ingest and export data from collaborating institutions in the wide area. So the science DMZ has been adopted in a wide variety of applications and by a wide variety of entities. The DOE Office of Science National Laboratories have deployed these. The National Science Foundation has, through several very successful programs, funded the development of science DMZs at many research institutions in the United States. Several government agencies have been involved in this as well. The National Institutes of Health has deployed science DMZs. The U.S. Department of Agriculture is building a new network infrastructure based on some of these ideas. NASA and NOAA are looking at them. From an international perspective, we've seen this in Australia and Brazil and other countries around the world. The science DMZ is at this point considered best practice for building data-intensive science infrastructure at major research institutions.